Well, good morning, Northshore. How is everybody doing this morning? So good to see your faces. Thank you, those of you joining us online, as we just take some time this morning to put everything aside and focus in on who God is. We're going to declare a lot about how great our God is. It's been a hard week for lots of folks. The Delta variant, the virus, is just rearing its ugly head. And I know that we've had some losses, and just communities are shaken at this moment. And so I encourage you to just take this time to focus your heart, your mind on God, how great He is, even in times of tragedy, in times of sorrow. We look to Him, and we just rely on His love, His grace, His mercy, and His peace in these times. So will you join us in just some praise and worship this morning? In on who God is. Say, God, we love you. We praise you. We lift up these songs as a sacrifice to you in this moment. We sing the splendor of the King. The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. Trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And oh, we'll see how great is our God. Age to age. And age to age he stands. Time is in his hands. Beginning and the end. Beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one. Father, Spirit, and Son. The Lion and great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And oh, we'll see how great is our God. Sing that verse again in Spanish. Toda la eternidad en su manos está, principio y final, principio y final. Bendita Trinidad, tres en uno son, Cordero y León, Cordero y León. Names. He's the name above. is our God. Declare it, name above all names. You're the name. Sing it out. How great is our God? How great is our God? Sing with me. How great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. It's so good that we can declare how great he is. Even when we're going through hard times, even when our hearts are weighed down with sadness or anxiety or worry, that we can declare our God is great. And we can lean on him. He is steadfast and sure.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. Thank you.
Grace abounds in deepest waters. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior.
For just a moment.
Good morning, family. Does good, doesn't it?
Amen.
Just to think upon the glory and the greatness of God, all who He is, His faithfulness, His grandeur, His beauty, His creation. And as we do, it just has a way of changing us. And I just pray that my lips, and I just want to say thank you that we paused and just declared the truth. He is that great. He is that great, and He is ever deserving of our praise. In fact, His word tells us, Matthew 11:28, Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest." A salvation rest and a rest now in the middle of all that's going on. He declares us to come and to take His yoke and to learn from Him. And He reminds that He is gentle and lowly in heart. And He will give rest for our souls. He reminds us, for His yoke is easy and His burden is light. You know, as we pause to really focus in on the presence of God and be reminded of those that are joining us, and just to call out as family the things that need to be prayed for, there's a lot today. And I just want to read it over you. And I'm grateful because I understand this body was not meant to carry the weight of that. And so I'm grateful for the blood of Jesus, who welcomes me and can handle it. And so I want to welcome our online family to Donna Bailey. God bless you. To the Rose family, the Raisy family. Got it wrong again. The Raisy family, and they've had so much sickness with the kids and different things. So praying, especially for Nolan, who's had some problems with breathing, and it's just kind of been throughout the family, and they've been to the doctors, and you understand if you had the little ones either now or before, so pray for the Raisies. Hello to Daryl, to Julie, to Laura Blomgren, to Linda, to Dana, and to Mary, and say thank you for joining our online family, and I just want to go through several of the prayer requests, if I can, that you would whisper even things unto the Lord as I go through these. Praying for Kaylee Bennett, 22 years old and had a stroke and has a hole in her heart. So praying for Kaylee this morning. Kendall, who's a young student, a former of Stacy's, found cancer in her leg and is going through chemo and all of that that goes with it. Of course, those in the path of Ida, the hurricane, we know what it's like. Just 4 years ago, Harvey hit here as a cat 4 or 5, and that's what many, in fact, Bridget's family has folks in the Thibodeau area, and there's others that we know of that have folks in Louisiana. The Zemos had some folks in Louisiana, so praying for them. Also praying just for the Ingleside community in the loss of the middle school counselor in her 50s, Miss Taylor, from COVID this last week. To Ray Rangel, part of our San Antonio family, had his knee replaced this week, and so praying for his recovery. Praying for the family of Johnny Avidia. He also passed from COVID. And there's just, we all know people right now that are either connected with that or are suffering with that. And so just crying out to God for his hands of mercy and his presence and his healing. Praying for Josh and Bailey Snurple. Praying for baby Nolan. Another appointment tomorrow. Nolan Raisy. Praying for guidance for Ashton and JC and for Dana. Praying for Kim Childs, who is moving houses. Praying for Virginia Montoya family in the loss. One of Johnny's friends, Randy, also another loss from COVID. The Lopez family. Ruben passed from COVID yesterday, and his wife is Carrie's assistant superintendent. For Marsha's dad, Marshall Rogers, who had an accident a week ago and has been in the hospital battling back and forth, and it's really been a roller coaster. And on a positive note, Brandon's with us this morning. Brandon and Avery got engaged a few weeks ago, so congratulations to them. He's down from A&M. The Aggie starts tomorrow along with my Aggie. So God bless you as you and others start. Also, Jeremy Steinmeier, a friend of Johnny and Carrie, has brain cancer and just some really rough treatments. And so much to carry, and the only safe place and right place to carry that family is to the Lord. And so could we join together in doing that? How great you are, God. We bless your name. We praise you. Thank you for your yoke is easy and your burden is light. We look and we read this list and it's overwhelming. And our hearts go out to so many tragedies. We know we're safe in you, Lord. We lift all of these things over to you, Lord, and just cry out on behalf of so many and families that are just hurting and needing a desperate touch from your presence, even in this moment. Oh, God, would you allow it to be so? We need you. God, for where there is wisdom needed, I pray your hand on it. Where there is discernment needed, whether there is encouragement needed, where there is divine healing needed. And God, we ultimately pray your will. We ask that your will be done and your kingdom come, all for your glory. We're grateful for this time. We worship you. We leave it at your feet and ask for your mercy and say we're grateful for your grace. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you stand?
The earth makes straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call every sinner, wake up the saint. Let every nation shout of your fame. Jesus is coming soon. Justice, though will be new, your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for God, we wait your coming soon. So we wait for you. God, we wait your coming soon. So we wait. So we wait. We wait for you. God, we wait. You're coming soon. So we wait. So we wait. We wait for you. God, we wait. You're coming. Even so come, Lord Jesus.
so come.
Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come.
So we wait.
So we wait. We wait for you. God, we wait. You're coming soon.
So we wait.
So we wait. We wait for you. God, we wait. You're coming soon.
So we wait. Sing it out, church.
So we wait. We wait for you. God, we wait. You're coming soon.
So we wait.
So we wait. We wait for you. God, we wait. You're coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church, we'll be ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing. Even so come, Lord Jesus. So come, Lord Jesus, come.
Even so come.
Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come.
God, we just ask you to come. Heal this land. Walk among us. Let us feel your presence. Give us a shoulder to lean on. Carry us when we're not strong enough. God, we just say we love you. We praise you. We worship you. You are great and greatly to be praised. It's in your name we pray. Amen. You may have a seat.
The word of the Lord, Revelation 22, verse 20 and 21. How it ends, folks. He who testifies to these things says, "Surely I am coming soon." Amen.
Amen.
Come, Lord Jesus. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with you all. Amen. Family, thank you so much for singing and worshiping and just turning your thoughts and your hearts towards Jesus. It ministered to me and forced my gaze upward. James chapter 3, starting verse 1. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers and sisters. For you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. As a teacher of the word, it almost gives me a little fear. I pray it gives me a holy fear. You know, I'm immediately reminded of what 2 Timothy 2:15 would say. So do your best to present yourself as one approved, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth. But as I wrestled with this from the beginning of the time that I knew I was being led to preach this by the Spirit. We have been talking of that faith without works is dead. And just as faith without works does not work, a living faith will be evidenced by my words. Whew. That means, you know, I've had to, and you ought to, test it with my family because they're around me all the time. That means that I should and you should look around and test it with our church family. That's not just something said, but it's something down to the core. Just as Jesus invited Peter to show faith by coming out on the water in Matthew 14, sometimes I think we lose the perspective and we just start focusing on what would be impossible. Like, okay, I can't walk on water, so we just start focusing on just the water aspect. But understand, the water was not calm. There was a raging storm. And so it wasn't just, will you sink and can you swim, by the way. He was being called out to something that he knew that he could not do, that he must have had a fear of, that the storm was raging. He had no promise of living. He had no promise that you're going to be okay. The other disciples in the boat weren't going, you can do it, you can do it, you can do it, Peter. I mean, they weren't doing that. They were like, don't call me. Don't call me. I mean, they were terrified. They were used to being on the water, and they thought they were about to die. And so you want me to go ahead and get out of the boat and try to walk on water? Crazy. That's not what I see. That's not what I feel. And yet Jesus said, come. This morning, the Spirit calls me to step out and to declare by faith, speaking in words, and reflect my confidence, honestly, when I don't feel like that. And honestly, when I look, I don't see it. Isn't that what faith is? So, I preached beginning to myself. So how will I respond? Will I take this text seriously? Will I wrestle with it? Will I go ahead and declare things that I cannot see and that I do not feel? But yet, will I trust and proclaim my confidence in Almighty God and still walk towards it? This post-pandemic time has been tough. It has tested my faith. It's tested it privately. It's tested it publicly as an under-shepherd of the church. Yet this morning I stand on Psalm 79:9. Help us, O God of our salvation, for the glory of your name. Deliver us and atone for our sins for your name's sake. My heart was drawn to try to apply this in my own heart and life through the words that God inspired Nehemiah. So in Nehemiah chapter 2, verse 17 through 20, I walk through that wrestling with what we've talked about already. That, okay, I know I'm going to be judged stricter for what I say and how I say it and why I say it and the core motivation of my heart, not just from you, but from the Lord. Will I respond? Not by what I see, not what I feel, but by the truth of what He is. The Lord, may it be so. Nehemiah 2:17. Nehemiah said, you see the trouble that we are in, how Jerusalem lies in ruins, with its gates burned. Now, this was not news to everybody in Jerusalem. I mean, for a while, the gates had been broken down. It had brought shame on them individually as a country and even ultimately to God, because these were God's chosen people, and yet they had rebelled against God, and God had brought promised judgment, and now they sat in fear and in guilt and in judgment, and people were literally laughing at them. And so even them coming to gather around Nehemiah, who showed up with all this fanfare, even them being there, I mean, they understood, and they were like, I know. And they looked around and went, yeah. But yet, even in the middle of that, they had grown somewhat comfortable with it. They had settled themselves to where it didn't bother them as much as it did in the beginning. And Nehemiah calls this to their attention. It's almost like, have you seen the show Hoarders? Those that are hoarding don't just have that happen to them overnight, do they? I mean, they don't just like wake up and go, oh my goodness, I didn't realize this. I mean, it's a late night buy after a late night buy after a run to the store buy to go to the mailbox stack, and it just happens over time, and nobody intends to get there, and then it becomes unmanageable, and then it becomes overwhelming, and then it just becomes a part of who they are. I think that was happening to them. Could I be unfiltered and say at times it's happening within, around us? Can I apply again God's word to our situation? How about even to my heart? How about even to North Shore Family Church? I'm mourning the loss of people from church. You're going. I'm weary of fighting the new normals. I'm heartbroken over the subtle spiritual warfare of people that are honestly deconstructing their faith and are just totally distancing themselves from God. It has caused me many sleepless nights, anxiety, depression, and a crisis of identity. Nehemiah continues to say, come, let us build the wall of Jerusalem that we may no longer suffer derision or disgrace. I see in Nehemiah, he had this confidence. I mean, think about this. We get to see the end of the story, and we go, yeah, Nehemiah was a great leader, and he prayed, and this happened, and so he just goes forward. But understand, when Nehemiah stood in front of them, he had to declare a faith that he did not see and that he surely did not feel. And Nehemiah's confidence in God, though, inspired him to go ahead and speak or voice a faith in God. But understand this, that ignited the faith of others that were around him. I mean, in a good way, in a way that he could ask them to unite together for seeking God's hand in redeeming their current story. I was encouraged even this week of how some faith has been sparked around me. Mindy, even just a few days ago, texted Stacy and I and just said, hey, I've been praying for you. And that was just, God knew at that time, I needed that. And it was just a wake-up call on how just a little bit of faith sparks some more faith in somewhere else. And let's not lose sight of that. You know, and I've also appreciated how just Mindy wanted to make a difference in her world. And so there was someone that was dealing with issues of getting around. And so she's been praying. She's been asking the Lord to provide a scooter for somebody that needs it. And so she started a GoFundMe. And she put some money in, and Addie's baked cookies, and people have been giving. And you, if you, the Lord leads you. Why? Because we've been praying for God to intervene in a certain place at a certain time, and just trusting that He will do that. Why? So we can glory in it? No, so God can get the ultimate glory, and people can be reminded, and people can understand that He knows where you are, and He knows what's going on, and He loves you, and He's drawing you towards Himself. Faith can spark a revolution. That's what was happening with Nehemiah. It goes on in verse 18. And I told them of the hand of my God that had been upon me for good, and also the words that the king had spoken to me. How often in these days, and even in this moment, even this morning, do we need to be reminded that God has the whole world in His hand? He spoke it into existence. He's not weighted down by what's going on. He's not going, well, I just can't believe it. I'm going to have to come back now because it's too much. No, He is not going to be rushed. We're going to have to wait. His time will come, but believe me, we can have the confidence that He will come, that He will do everything that He said. And there was something about Nehemiah going back to the truth of God's faithfulness and reminded himself and others that this is about eternal impact, not external outcome. Okay, that applies to me as an individual. That applies to you and your job and your field and your family. That applies to us as a church. And it's so easy to lose sight of that and be drained of our confidence and drained of our faith. And we need to speak up and speak the truth that God is alive and well. He is accomplishing everything He's set out to accomplish in His time. And He will come back in all His glory. Makes me pause and go, in fact, Robert brought to mind just a song this week, a Danny Gokey song, and it was just that He's got the whole world in His hands. And maybe you sang a song version of that in Bible school. It's the truth that we need to remember. Could I just apply that I've had to work through and wrestle through even myself? The youth small group last Sunday was just fantastic. And the breakthroughs even there that I heard in students understanding that there is a difference between an association of faith and a faith that works. I mean, some people never get that. And to hear it come out of young voices, I was just like, yes! How about just the fact that we get to be in a building after so long being online and starting a pandemic, and it was going well, and then losing a place that we didn't know where we would go, and then God opened something like this? I'm grateful. How about just the impact, thinking of the conversations and the prayer time and the encouragement from just some small group discipleship that's happened over the last few months. And again, it's small group, so it's just a few people. And maybe you didn't get to see that, but I've got to recognize and I've got to come back and just go, yes, Jesus, look at what You're doing. Remember, this is about eternal impact, not external outcome. And in that, I'm finding my heart fueled. There's some people that are online that I've had some great conversations with. You know, and it'd be easy for us to rule that out that, well, maybe that doesn't matter as much because they're not in the room. You do. And, you know, God bless you and thank you for being a part of the family. That's the new reality. And I thank God for the resources and the technology to do that. Because you think about it from a redeeming perspective, God could transmit a message of truth all over the world instantaneous right now. Glory to God. He has not left us alone. And so even if you can't be here in person, And some of you have experienced the other side of that. Even if you can't be here in person, sure, that would be our thing, because there's nothing just like looking at you in the eye and feeling that back and forth and having our hearts warmed with that. There's nothing like that. However, you know, there are some online that are being touched and that God is being faithful to his word, to Isaiah 55:11, to go forth and accomplish everything that he's meant to accomplish. So God bless you online. How about even God's provision during this time was a reminder? Because again, it's been frustrating. It's been hit or miss. And yes, people have been going through real tragedies and sickness, and we just got to be careful in this time. And yet, in the middle of that, the Lord has just seen fit by his mercy and his grace to allow us to have provision to where I've never had to speak of it during the pandemic. And I'm grateful to you for giving. I'm grateful for there are some that are giving that you've never seen. You've never seen. And God's using it to continue this place and at this time for a reason. Luke 17 was a part of our read through the Bible devotion even this last week. And as Jesus talked to the 10 lepers and they were asking Jesus to heal them, and in that verse 14 through 19, Jesus said, "Well, go on your way to the priest and you'll be healed." And as they went, as they followed what Jesus told them, they were being healed. But one turned back. One turned back and understood this was not just of them and for them. This was something greater for God's glory. And he turned back and he went and followed Jesus. He went and praised Jesus. And Jesus declared, "Where are the other nine?" So often do we get distracted by what we're seeing and what we're feeling that we miss the things that God is doing. And how he has provided, and how we do have much to be grateful for. So Nehemiah continues, the second part of verse 18. And they said, "Well, let us rise up and build." So they strengthened their hands for the good work. But when Sanballat the Horonite, and Tobiah the Ammonite, and Geshem the Arab heard of it, they jeered at us and they despised us. "What is this thing that you're doing? Are you rebelling against the king? Isn't it amazing once that you go ahead and declare your faith and go ahead and stand on the truth, even though it's not what you feel and what you see?" There really comes down to two responses. Will you say yes and be strengthened by what God is doing? Or will you say no and turn and be a critic of what God's doing and not be a part of the profitable work? See, we have two responses. A servant response, and notice how they had rehearsed the little things and they were strengthened and they were refreshed for the good work. Or there was a critical response and they were distracted and suppressed from any profitable work. Now today, I come to you not saying which camp are you in, because it would be easy, "Well, I know the person like that," or "I know." No, I'm not asking you that. I'm saying, honestly, if we were completely transparent with each other, we can find the evidence of both of those in us, can't we? Aren't there times that we just come in with a critical spirit? Aren't there times we just come into the room that we're ready to serve? What's the difference? What is the connector of those things? Let me tell you, it's where your faith is. It's where your faith is. If your faith is in, "Okay, my confidence is in you, my trust is in you, God," what is the tendency going to be? Your heart's going to be ready to serve. Your heart's going to be strengthened when you hear the good news of God's grace and the little things that he's doing. You're going to be focused on eternal outcomes. But if not, what is this world going to pull you towards? What even in our not right days are going to pull others towards? Towards being a critical spirit and suppressing a move of God. We've all got that in us. Oh, would the Lord strengthen our faith in these moments? It comes to this. What will it take us as individuals, as families, as this church family, to have a heart that says, let's rise and rebuild? It comes down to act on faith. Act on our faith. Would you just say that with me? Act on our faith. Act on our faith. What does that stand for? What does that mean? Can I put some legs to that? One, we need to ultimately acknowledge God's glory and heart. Acknowledge God's glory and heart. It starts there. It doesn't end there. He's not waiting for us to finish and be successful and then props. Oh, would we have a faith that would start with him? That would start with him and declare, God, you are all that. Even when we don't see it. Even when we don't feel it. That's faith. Acknowledge God's glory. Acknowledge God's good heart. Acknowledge he's going to do everything. I love the psalmist. Psalm 24, you could read the whole thing. I just want to read a few verses. Psalm of David. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and all those who dwell in it. We need to remember that sometimes when we take in too much news or see too much social media or hear too much from our friends or just feel it, because we know so many people that are going through tough times. Verse 10 says, who is the King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the alone King of glory. We first just need to acknowledge God's glory in this moment and continually, and go back to God's heart. Second thing is for me to commit to having a healthy faith. Again, I felt like this was a wrestling match all week. Could and would I say the things that I know are true, even when I go, there's a blank table over there, and there's part of me that's pulled of that. Would I go ahead and say and declare the things, even when I know there's multiple times this week that I got up way too early because I was just carrying it? We need to commit to having a healthy faith. And it's not just by what I do, but it's what I go ahead and declare, even when I don't see it, and even when I don't feel it. Psalm 20, verse 6 through 8. Happened to be some memory verses that were on target for me this week. Now I know that the Lord saves his anointed. He will answer him from his holy heaven with the saving might of his right hand. Again, just a reminder, he's got the whole world in his hands. Some trust in chariots, some in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God. They will collapse and fall, but we will rise and stand upright. How about that? Amen. Oh God, spark our faith with that. You and I need to reassess and come back to, before anything else, just act, acknowledge on the glory of God and his heart. Then we need to do a self-study and go, oh, may my heart be in the right place. And third, is just take ownership of rebuilding the broken walls. You know, even as Nehemiah talked and they looked around, you know what the difference maker was? After they acknowledged all that was going on, they were just honest. And then they had started with the heart of God. They'd prayed it up before they even had a meeting. And they acknowledged the glory of God and they acknowledged his heart and they committed, okay, I'm gaining this. As you stand up and you declare your faith and trust in God, I'm going to lean on that too. And they were strengthened in that moment. And then what did they do? They went by their house and they started building. You know, they didn't go, we've got to do the whole project. They started repairing what was close to them first. And God, in 52 days, did a revolution. A revolution in the hearts of people, in the heart of the land. Why? Because they took ownership of their faith. and begin to rebuild broken walls. How does that flesh out for us? There are things day after day that we are being invited in. Will we help repair by faith the broken walls in our culture? Will we help repair the broken walls in our family? Will we help and go after those people that have distanced themselves from the faith during this time because they were online or they were offline so long that they just got out of the habit and they don't know what's really real or not right now? And so they need someone that does and is assured and has a faith that does to go be a spark and go after them and not give up on them. We need to take ownership of our faith and understand that God has us in this place for a reason. You know, sure, it was easy for Esther to go, after the fact, oh, he must have had me in this place and at this time for a reason. But her life was on the line. How did Nehemiah feel before standing before? And there's broken down, and others had tried to rebuild the walls, and they had failed. And there was no assurance that this would end positively. And yet, he was forced to declare his faith and declare the truth of who God is and have his confidence in him and say, if the Lord wills, why not use us to make it happen? To take ownership of rebuilding the broken walls. I'm reminded of Psalm 127, verse 1. Unless the Lord builds the house, those who build it labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. You know, when it comes down to it, rebuilding was not really about bricks and mortar. Rebuilding this church is not about filling the seats. I hope you can hear me and hear my heart. But about removing the obstacles, keeping God's people from standing strong, and expressing it in faith by works. That's what it's going to take. As people act on faith, the Lord seems to transform hearts and lands. Listen to Nehemiah's final words. Nehemiah 2:20. He replied, "The God of heaven will make us prosper." He didn't know, but he had confidence in the Lord. "The God of heaven will make us prosper. And we, his servants," there was a choice. Am I going to be a servant or a critic? "We, his servants, will rise and build." Based on the authority of the word, can I look at you? Can I preach it myself in the mirror? Can I look at you online? Oh God, let us rise and rebuild. Let's pray together. Lord, I thank you that your word is enough. And I declare on what I know, even when it's not what I see or feel, for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Just for a moment, I want to encourage you, even with some next steps that are on the screen and are reminders, maybe you need to look and be reminded of recommitting your heart, even in this moment, to Jesus Christ. There may be somebody here or online that goes, you know what, I've been taking that for granted. And, you know, nothing would bless the Lord more, that even greater than our singing, even greater than what we feel, just recognizing the truth of what he is. So I encourage you, recommit your heart to the Lord. Maybe someone needs to do that for the first time and get in touch with us. We'll encourage you. Also, somebody may need to be baptized as a symbol of what they've done on the inside. Please talk to us about that. And this is your opportunity also to give your gifts and talents to the Lord. Those are primarily done online nowadays, but we do have some things at the back. And just again, say thank you so much for your faithfulness and God allowing that to not be something that's been an upfront worry during a time when there's been plenty to worry about. And then what from here? Well, before we even send you out, we give you an opportunity to discuss that amongst family members so it's not just you listen, but that we can talk about it before you leave. And that's why we have family groups now. That's why we have some in-person gatherings as far as the men meet on Tuesday, youth are meeting on Wednesday, the ladies are meeting on Thursday. Also, just a reminder that this message was never meant to end here, that hopefully you understand by the grace of God, you're now on mission as an ambassador of the word that you heard from Northshore Family Church to go out and share that. Look for that opportunity. Pray for those spiritually divine appointments. Somebody's going to ask you, and then somebody's going to distract you from it. What will you do with it? Oh, may the Lord ignite a spark of faith in you to pass it on to somebody else this week. Look for it. And then understand we have a stewardship. We have a stewardship to go out and link arms with people that are around us and go, come on, let's come back and gather. Because it was great today. Come back and let's gather together and honor God by building the walls together. Huh? God bless you and thank you to those that are joining us online. And for those that are here, we're going to spend just a few moments and talk. There are a few different states.